Welcome to the Reality Revolution. I'm your host, Brian Scott, and today I'm so happy to return to Dr. Frank B. Robinson, and in particular, the lessons in Psychiana, the teaching that is bringing new life to a spiritually dead world. This, again, is a set of lessons that were sent by mail a long time ago. In 1932, they were an advanced course in the study of the living God. It's really an advanced course in the law of attraction and accessing the God power. If you've had a chance, we've had two lessons so far, and they've come up with some very powerful affirmations to start off with. If you follow these lessons, I'm releasing them every 2 weeks, as he did. He would send out this letter in the mail with this lesson, and people would go through these lessons, and each one builds upon itself. But again, you don't need to listen to these sequentially. You can listen to this individually, and it's fine. Each one is powerful, and the more I read it, the more excited I am for the next one. Lesson number 3, Psychiana. Dear friend and fellow student, in our search for the law, which controls health, wealth, and happiness, it is necessary at this point that we turn our attention to the creation of this universe and man. It might occur to you that it is passing strange that a consideration of creation is necessary when all we are attempting to do is to find the law which is responsible for success, health, and happiness. You may say, well, what has the story of creation to do with either health, success, or happiness? And my answer to you is that it has a whole lot to do with it. In fact, you cannot obtain any of these blessings intelligently until you have a true picture of creation. For behind that picture of creation lies a power. And what a power it is. Were it not for that mighty power or law, you and I would not be here. Neither could we possibly stay here another second of time. The fact that there is a creation presupposes, in fact, proves that there is a creator. It would be utter foolishness to think for one moment that yon heavens, decked in all their glory and splendor, together with their millions of satellites, planets, suns, stars, etc., just haphazardly happened. To think that would be utter foolishness, for the remarkable precision with which yon starry spheres revolve in their orbits and travel along their respective paths through infinite space is proof beyond shadow of doubt that an intelligent power or law is in control. And not only is this force or power or law in control every second of time, but this same power or law was the causing factor in the first place. This same power, this same law, this same force, no matter what it may be called, and we will not concern ourselves with that yet. This same law is the very same law that caused them to be in the first place. I do not care when the creation was. I do not care so much how it happened. I do know that whether it be a power, a law, or a force, it must be an intelligent power or law or force. By no mere chance could such an elaborate scheme of things ever come into existence without some controlling power overlooking and controlling this brilliant scheme of things. For in reality, it is a very brilliant scheme when we only faintly begin to understand something of the power operating. And you are going to be given a glimpse of this very power, so study earnestly and intently, and drink in every word I say to you. I can assure you that this course of instruction has not sprung into existence overnight. I promise you that. It has involved a lifetime's study and thought along this line and in this realm. At times, I've had to be rather daring. At other times, I've had to do lots of experimenting in this remarkable realm. But in being able to point you direct to the law as it exists, I think my efforts have been more than justified. I think my reward is great. So realize, my friend, that I am putting into your hands a weapon which you can use against all the enemies of life. And if you will use this weapon as a direct you to use it, you will be an absolutely overcoming warrior in life's battle. For life is a battle to those who do not know it as it is. Of course, it's a fight when one does not understand the mighty law waiting to be used for either success, health, or happiness. But let me say to you here and now that life lost its fight when I began to realize the magnitude of the staggering truths I'm revealing to you. Now, instead of fighting, I know a far better way, and then I use it. And success follows everything I do. I am perfectly healthy, and I am supremely happy also. And it is all because I learned something of the existence of this mighty creative life principle I am teaching you about. Now, instead of being defeated at every turn of the road, I win all around. Now, instead of spending half my time in a sickbed, I hardly ever see one. Now, instead of moping around disgruntled with myself and with everybody else, you will generally find a smile on my face and a joke on my lips. And that's much better than the other way, is it not? This success and this happiness is for you also, if you obey me. So study carefully if you are not quite clear on any point. Read it again. And then, if still not clear, drop me a line. I will answer it. Now, to get back to our story of creation and the marvelous realm it opens up, I have stated that it is absolutely necessary for you to understand a little about this scheme of creation and also about your relationship to both the creation and the creative life principle. Although perhaps not quite in the way in which you have been taught to believe in that mighty power. If you were raised in the type of Christian home that I was, you were probably told that God was a very wonderful person, having his dwelling place far beyond the starry sky. You were probably led to believe that someday this God, who is personality, would stand you up before a judgment bar and would reward you according to the deeds done by you while here on the earth. In other words, like myself, you were probably told that God was a person of some sort. Which person was responsible for you being here? I have no quarrel with anyone holding that theory. However, I just don't believe it, that's all. And I don't think you believe it either. However, that's beside the point here. The thought I want you to grasp here is that this same intelligence that created the earth and the heavens and their firmament is the very same power that created you. And in passing, did it ever occur to you what a marvelous power or law this must be? Did you ever stop to think of the marvels of the creation of a human body? You, no matter who you are at this moment, 100 years ago did not exist. At some time or other, your parents complied with the law governing the birth of a child, and you were born. It sounds simple, doesn't it? But have you ever stopped to think the marvelous intelligence of the creative life principle in doing that seemingly simple little thing? Try and catch this point, and catch it well. When your two parents had complied with the law governing the birth of a child, that was as far as they could go. They could do positively nothing more. The building of the body from those two tiny little germs, the ovum of the female and the spermatozoa of the male, was an operation entirely removed from the power of your parents, but it was done just the same. And in due time came forth you. And without any help of any sort, after the first operation of joining those two germs together was done by your parents, nothing more could be done by any human agency. Did you ever stop to think of that? Did it ever occur to you that whatever power or intelligence, law or force did the building must be a mighty, powerful, and intelligent one? Did that ever occur to you? And did it ever occur to you that if this creative life principle, for that's what I call it, could supervise with unerring precision the building of a human body from two tiny germ cells, it also must be expected to sustain the human body that it had built? Never thought of that, did you? And you never once thought that such almost inexplicable intelligence as that could ever be called upon to bring you health, wealth, and happiness, did you? Of course you didn't, for it has never been called to your attention before that I am aware of. This one point, my friend, opens up a realm which will stagger you when you quietly think of it in the light of what I have just told you. Here, I sit at this typewriter, a marvelous piece of human mechanism. Yet 46 years ago, I was absolutely unborn. Today, I'm able to influence the lives of tens of thousands. Yet 46 years ago, I simply wasn't in existence. And it is the power or law of this life spirit which caused me to be, that I am talking about. I have no use for any system or philosophy or religion which relegates its God to the far regions and which promises its reward beyond Jordan. Nor have I any use for any system that holds over one's head the threat of eternal damnation, unless the particular brand of theology is believed in. That stuff is all pagan superstition and should be relegated to the dark ages of faith from whence it came. For the theory does not stand up under intelligent investigation. I am not concerned with that sort of a God at all, my friend, for there is no such being. But I am vitally concerned with this ever-present life spirit, which only 46 years ago went to work on the building of my human body. I have a right to be interested in that power. I have a right to know the law, for we should be very intimate seeing that it brought me here, and along this very line have been conducted all the experiments, and all my thoughts for the past 40 years have been given to understanding something of the application of this mighty God law. This life spirit for the obtaining of the things I needed most, and that was what I was interested in, and that was what I wanted to find out. I wanted to know whether or not the mighty dynamic power, intelligent power, if you please, which created this universe especially, could be brought into play for the achieving of the things I wanted and needed here and now. My parents told me that we never could understand God. My father, still a good old Baptist preacher, often said to me in answer to my questionings, "Well, son, the finite can never grasp the infinite. That is reserved for the angels." Dad, maybe so, and then again, maybe not so. At any rate, there was no law that I knew of which prohibited me from trying to find out or from thinking for myself. Nor was there any law which prohibited me from trying to find out whether or not God, as we call him, could be understood. Just because my old father and the other preachers told me that it was not meant for me to know was no reason for me believing them at all. Not that Dad or the preachers were dishonest. Not that. But one must remember that those old beliefs had their origin in an age of religion, superstition, and intolerance. It's not so long ago since the Christian fires were burning all over Europe, torturing to death hundreds of thousands of heretics. And all a heretic ever was one who would not believe the story these religionists asked him or her to believe. All that is history now, however, but in passing, it is well to remember that the statement that we cannot know God until we die originated at the same source as these burnings. You cannot burn people alive today for their religious beliefs, can you? Perhaps it is a good job too, for maybe there might be some who would want to fry me up a little. But to progress, I doubted the statement that God could not be known till after death. I analyzed the stories and theories told to me, and I also ran down the sacred book telling the story. It may appeal to some people, and if it does, they are welcome to it. It did not and does not appeal to me, especially as I now know that the story is not true. For right now, I know that the mighty life spirit can be used for health, success, and happiness by every soul knowing the law of this mighty life spirit. I did it, and so can you. It would be absolutely false to state that this life spirit, which could take two germs and make a human body out of them, could not do a single thing towards making that body happy after it had made it in the first place. This is a very revolutionary theory, but it's a true theory, as you will find out before you finish your studies with me. Can it actually be done, you ask? Wait and see. But for your information, let me say to you right here that it can certainly be done. The same great power, the same great law, the same great force which created you and me in the first place can do for us now whatever right thing is necessary to be done. It displayed superhuman intelligence in making us in the first place and can do for you and for me whatever is necessary to be done. And more than that, it will display the same superhuman intelligence in providing for us that it displayed in making us. Who said the mighty power of this life-creating spirit was limited to the manufacture of a human body from a two-germ cell? Who said so? I deny it, and deny it with all the power I have. And more than that, I will prove to you, my friend, before you finish your studies, that the power of this mighty creative life spirit is just as potent today as it ever was. If 46 years ago this power could start building me, don't tell me that 46 years later it has lost all power over me. Not by a long shot. It's all a matter of knowing the secret of invoking this power, that's all. The story of creation, as told me by my parents, was the usual one given out by religious people. God created the world, the sun, the moon, and the stars, and Adam and Eve in 6 literal days. That's the story I was told as a youth. I have had lots of arguments with ministers over the story of creation. They try to tell me that the days were periods of time, but that argument will not hold water, for the writer distinctly states, "And the morning and evening were the first day," etc. The word used in those passages means a literal of 24 hours, so this theory will have to be discarded, as we know by scientific facts that the earth was in existence long before 6,000 years ago. At the very least, reckoning it is at least 500,000 years old, and probably many millions of years old. I mention this 6-day story in order to deal with 2 stories of creation given to us, one by religionists and the other by scientists, for the benefit of those who still take the 6-day story to be true, but to mean periods of time. Let me say that the Westminster Confession of Faith in full force today, and that confession makes belief in the literal 6-day mandatory creation to salvation, whatever that may be. Then we have the scientific theory. This is the theory of evolution and is universally accepted by thinking people today. It is taught in nearly every university in America and is accepted by almost every reasoning mind. According to this theory, the first known cell having life and intelligence was the humble algae, a jelly-like mass that floated on top of stagnant water. Then came the equally humble amoeba, a one-celled piece of protoplasm and having life and intelligence. We are told that this little one-celled piece of protoplasm had ability enough to float to the top of the water or sink as needs be. And from this little amoeba, millions and millions of ages ago, are you and I presumed to be sprung. This is a lot of reason and truth in that story. It was probably a way back when it happened. But those knowing that the story of evolution know by its unmistakable evidence that quite likely the theory is correct. At any rate, it is far more reasonable and far more scientific than is the 6-day theory, which theory, by the way, although all the rage 100 years ago, is practically extinct today. It goes to show how intelligence increases, and how as intelligence increases, ideas change, and always for the better. One cannot say with certainty that all life sprang from the tiny amoeba, but one can say with absolute assurance that behind the human race and behind life itself are ever-growing and evolutionary processes. There was no instantaneous creation, nor did any supreme being say, "Let there be light," or anything on that order. It is pretty well established today that this story is but an old Chaldean allegory, and of course it is treated as such. True, there are still those to be found who say they believe that the mighty creative intelligence had an argument with a talking snake in the Garden of Eden one day, and of course, they may be right. At any rate, I grant them the right to believe that if they want to. That's their business. It's my business also not to believe it if I want to. And I certainly don't want to. Now, whichever story is correct or incorrect is quite beside the point here. So we shall not quibble and quarrel as to whether evolution is the answer or whether instantaneous creation is the answer. For it makes no difference at all in our search for this mighty law which did the creating in the first place. What you and I are trying to do is get a clear-cut picture of the creative life spirit, which life spirit can and does manifest in the life of everyone, not only as their physical creator, but as their sustainer and provider of all things needed, whether success, health, or happiness. That is what we are after, and I say it is quite immaterial, by what means the first creation sprang into existence. The fact that there is a creation is enough to warrant the existence of a creating living spirit. There are at least 50 stories in existence of gods who created the earth, and while of course they are all more or less allegorical in their origin, I'm not so sure that they all do not carry a hidden truth in them. Take the Bible story of creation, for instance. The story is not accepted as written. In that story you find this passage, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. Now, if the findings of science regarding the floating of the little amoeba on the waters is correct, then you see there is no clash at all. So, in all these systems of religion, as I study them, I do not, of course, believe them literally, but perhaps they all contain a truth under their clothing of words. If there ever is a clash between any religion book or any religious history and science, then science must come first. For what science knows, it knows. Scientific facts are known facts, and all the religious history of the world cannot refute one scientific fact of truth. There is no question in my mind that some of those old timers of Bible history had inspirations from the creative life spirit. No question at all. But at the same time, we believe the spit and mud story of creation to be false. We do not believe the God and talking snake yarn either. There is no question in my mind that John Greenleaf Whittier had a revelation from the life spirit when he penned his beautiful lines. I know not where his islands reach. Their fronded palms in air. I only know I cannot drift beyond his love and care. Nor is there any doubt in my mind that this beautiful old soul, Cardinal Newman, knew something of the power of the creative intelligence when he wrote the marvelous old hymn, Lead Kindly Light. No question at all is there any mind about that. The trouble with those old fellows was that they starved the body and pinched the soul, lived as pilgrims here on earth, denying themselves this and denying themselves that in order they might go to heaven. They taught that a rich man could not enter into heaven. They gave not a second thought to this life, but concentrated on heaven without even knowing whether or not there was such a place. Consequently, the life spirit could do nothing for them, for the simple reason they did not expect it to. They thought that every good thing was for the other side and not for here and now. And that is where they have all missed the point. I claim and will prove to you that this same mighty creative life spirit is as active now as it ever was and is abundantly able to bring into being in your life all the success you can ever need, all the health you can ever need, and all the happiness you can ever need. I found it. I was transformed from poverty to plenty in 18 months, too. So you would have a hard time trying to convince me that this mighty God law is for use only on the other side. It may be for the other side, all right, but it is also for this side. Now here, I want to take a look at the creation story as told in the Bible. Of course, you will realize that I am not taking it literally at all. What I am doing is taking from the allegorical story the truth as it exists. For the truth is certainly told in allegory and told very plainly too. As you progress with me, you will find that the unseen, or shall I say, the spiritual part of man and of creation, is by far the most important part. Remember that. For the power you are using and are to use further is an unseen power. You will see the manifestations of it, certainly in a material way, but the power itself is unseen. Don't forget that. It has to be an invisible power. There could be no power controlling the material and the physical unless it were an unseen spiritual power. Do you follow me? Now, let us look at the story for a moment briefly, and I think you will see just what I'm driving at. I'm sure you will see the mighty law at work. Read this lesson over and over again and try and grasp a little of the truth as I am giving it to you. I cannot give you much at a lesson, for you might miss it, but you see that what little I am giving you is dynamic, don't you? Right here, and in fact all through this course of instruction, you and I are dealing with the most dynamic and important law in the universe. And this law is to be used in your case to manifest plenty of every good thing you desire. So follow me closely from now on, for it will pay you to do so. Here we go. The scriptures inform us that no man has ever seen God at any time, nor indeed could he. So whatever inspiration or revelation Moses had was received in the very same manner in which you and I may receive our revelations or our inspirations. Moses did not see God. and neither has anyone else, at any time nor in any place. You can bank on that. Were I to go to the leaders of our great religious denominations, existing, by the way, for the express purpose of teaching the truths about God, so they say, and were I to say to those leaders, "Sirs, I want you to tell me how your God made the world," I wonder what sort of answer I should get. I should in all probability be told they did not know. I should also be told in all probability that no one else knew either, and that it has not been given it man to know just how this created world came to be. I might also be told that the scriptures were silent on that point, giving us no information at all. Ever since our present system of religion sprang into existence, we have been taught that it was a mystery just how God did this. But wait a minute, for if ever a story was plainly told in any book, then the story of creation is plainly told in the Bible. Why it should be considered such a mystery or so hard to understand is a great mystery by far to me. Read and reread a million times by ministers throughout all Christian countries and by those supposed to be teaching Bible truths, the story seems to be clothed in impenetrable mystery to this day, and the plain, simple truth of it all seems to have been missed in its entirety. Here, we find the key lying on top of a puzzle where it usually lies, and if Moses could have put in any plainer, then I do not see how he could have done it. Listen carefully. It's so wonderfully simple, yet so wonderfully profound. The first two verses in the Bible give us the story of creation as it actually happened. Now read carefully as I unfold it to you. Genesis reads as follows. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Here we have a definite statement to the effect that God, and we shall not concern ourselves here with what God is, did a certain thing. He performed a certain act. He accomplished a certain piece of work. The statement is in the past tense and speaks of the deed as having been done. It had been actually accomplished. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. There can be no question to what that means, can there? A certain person or power, something or other, which was God, did a certain deed. It was done, past tense. This great power or spirit or force, whatever it might be, had created the heavens and the earth. Nothing so very hard to understand about that, is there? In this sense, the statement is no harder to understand than if I said to you, "My little boy Alfred built a toy house out of the blocks today." It would only signify that something had been done. That is the point I want to get across to you here. This earth had already been created, for this is what that statement of Brother Moses signifies and means, and it means nothing else. It was finished. The heavens and the earth had been created. I believe you will grasp that, but if not, then please read it again until you grasp it, for it is very important. Your understanding of this entire course rests upon your properly grasping this one point here. Now watch the next statement and mark well here that we have no way of knowing just how long a time elapsed between the first statement and this next one. Furthermore, it makes no difference whether it was 1 second or 10 billion years. The fact as stated stands, the heavens and the earth had been created. Now, grasp this next statement to the very full because it might be important. And the earth was without form and void. Now I ask you as a man or woman of common sense, what sort of being would you be if you had already been created and still were without form and void? Answer that, and you have the answer to the question. How did God make the earth, and what sort of creation was it? If you and I created things were without form and void, then certainly we should be invisible or spiritual beings, would we not? And if we were without form, then we were not visible, were we? You cannot see anything that has not a form, can you? And if the creation of this earth and man was, as Brother Moses says, then it could not have been a visible creation, could it? And if it were not a visible creation, then what sort of creation was it? My friend and student, there is only one sort of a creation that it could possibly have been. If the story of the Bible is correct, and that is a spiritual creation or an invisible creation, this fact is entirely foreign to the views that have been held for so long by the exponents of the Christian religion. But it is the story of the first creation just the same, and told exactly as the Bible tells it. The actual materialization of the spiritual or invisible creation did not take place for a long time, millions of years, after the original invisible creation was an accomplished fact. If you read a little further into the Genesis account of it, you will find that it was a later date that the herbs, trees, etc. were called into being. You will also note that an entirely different method was used by God in manifesting physically the things that he had already created. Now mark me well, this point I'm trying to make here is that the creation of the earth and the actual manifestation of it were two entirely separate and different creations, each requiring a different method of operation on the part of the creative life principle. And now I am going to leave you for a couple of weeks when we shall go into the other part of creation. It's mighty interesting, I know, and it is necessary for you to grasp it in full and understand the workings and the relationship between you and the power that created you. For remember, that very same creative life principle which went to work on those two little germs 9 months before you were born is still at work in your life today, and just as effectively can it adjust your affairs in everyday life. Remember that. It did not place you on this earth a crying, squalling baby and then say, well, goodbye, baby, shift for yourself now. Not that. It did not say, I've made you and put you here and you can paddle your own canoe from now on. Not at all. Now remember what I am saying to you, please, for it's mighty important. That same mighty creative God law is still here and is still overseeing every movement of your life. It is still a very vital part of you, although not connected with your physical system in any way, shape, or form. And don't you forget it either. Now listen to me some more, and whoever you may be, this same creative life spirit can do for you now and in a material way with your cooperation whatever is necessary for you to have complete happiness here on earth. And you will find out as you continue your studies with me that there is no personality of any kind connected with this creative life principle or spirit. You will find that it is a law, and as such it cannot fail when the conditions are complied with. I think I have plainly put across to you the fact that you are still in a very vital association with the creative intelligence behind this created universe. If you do not see it quite plainly yet, you will as we journey along together during the next few months. Let me tell you a little advanced secret at this point. If it were not for such an existing connection, you would not exist another second. I think you can see, though, that the very same intelligence which began to manifest when you were a combination of two tiny germ cells is still manifesting in your own individual life. You will admit that, and right away you will want to know if it is possible for you to get acquainted with this mighty creative God law. And my advance answer to your question is yes, 1,000 times yes. What do you think of that? Are your hopes rising a little higher now? You are really beginning at this point to believe that what I claim might possibly be true, are you not? Well, if you are, let me say to you that you can raise your hopes just as big as you want to, for there are no limitations that I have ever been able to find to the power of this mighty God law. If there are limitations in your own life, then that is because you, through ignorance of the God law, probably impose such limitations yourself. And from now on, I know that you are not going to do this. In your last lesson, I gave you a few bedtime exercises and some few instructions, not many, but enough to give you a little start on the road with me. I want these instructions to be carried out faithfully while you are studying with me. They are dynamic, I assure you, for whether you know it or not, your thought life is by far the most important part of you. You are what you are now because of what someone else and you yourself have thought. In other words, you are directly, as a result of thought, on the part of someone, and certainly on the part of yourself. In years gone by, say 100 years ago, the Caucasian race was far different from what it is now. In those days, not so far back, people's thoughts were very different from what they are now, and they were limited by those thoughts. It is not the one who sees limitations who gets anywhere. It is the one who can think above all limitations, for there never was a single thing created yet that was not created in thought first. Take the building in which I am sitting while writing this. There was a time, and not so far back either, when no building stood here. I want to trace the actual happenings in the construction of this and every other building for that matter. First, an architect was engaged and he was told what sort of building he wanted and how much it would cost. Then, this architect sat down and visualized this building in his own thought realm. He drew a thought picture of what the building should look like, but the entire operation was performed entirely in the realm of thought. Remember this, after the architect had drawn his thought picture of what the finished building should look like, then, and not before then, did he transfer his thought results to paper in order they might be permanent and in order that the actual builder might build the building now, which was the more important operation of the two. The thinking out of the building in the thought realm of the architect or the actual mechanical work by the builder. Certainly not the latter, for this man worked mechanically and entirely according to the blueprint which originated in the thought realm of the architect. In our office there is a very intricate electrical machine. It seems almost human. As fast as one of our operators can write a letter on a typewriter, this machine sets that type into pages and actually does the work of 10 people setting the type single-handed. I happen to know that the development of this machine took years and years. Of what? Why, thought, of course. The men responsible for this marvelous piece of mechanism thought and thought and thought. Then, when they had the correct thoughts, they put them down on paper, drawing the result of their thought. And this machine, which but a few years ago did not exist, now is an actual thing and is being used by us in the printing of millions of sheets of paper. But the all-important thing for you to grasp is the fact that the actual making of this machine was done in the unseen realm. It was done in the thought realm, and you cannot get around that, can you? Had there been no thought realm, had there been no thought creation, there would have been no electrical typesetting machine in my offices. I assure you, take the radio. There would be no such thing in existence as radio had not Mr. Marconi spent hours and days and weeks and months and years of intensive thought. As a thought would crystallize, he would put it down on paper and it would be turned into an actual thing. The actual mechanical manufacture of the parts of a radio is entirely secondary to the thought force which brought radio into being. You may take any created thing you care to, and if you investigate it carefully, you will find that its first cause lies nowhere else than in the unseen realm of thought. Let that sink in, please. It's vital to your finding the law underlying success, health, and happiness. We think all too little of such simple things as thoughts. We don't pay much attention to them, and yet they are the most dynamic things in existence. For there never was a man or woman yet that could ever rise higher than he or she could think. And when I say think, I mean think, not dream. And the chances are many to one that if you are a failure, the reason why you are a failure is because failure thoughts have been predominating thoughts of your life. You cannot continually think failure without being a failure, nor can you continually think success without being a success. Oftentimes, one must force himself to think success thoughts, but that makes no difference, for the results are sure, for the law of God is immutable. It never fails. It never changes. And just as sure as day follows night, if the preponderance of your thought is success thought, the preponderance of your life will lie in the realm of success. You may make up your mind here also that the God law is sure and inviolate, and any failure to manifest success or happiness must and will be a failure on your part to comply with this mighty law. By no possible means can this law fail, and so by no possible means can you ever manifest either health, success, or happiness if your mind is full of thoughts of failure, unhappiness, and disease. That cannot be. It is not the God law that it should be, and this God law cannot work on your everyday life unless the conditions governing it are complied with. So I say to you, whoever you may be, give me the benefit of the doubt at this point, for I assure you, I know the way, and I shall not mislead you one step. I know whereof I speak, and every thinking man and woman will know from the angle from which I am approaching this subject that I do know whereof I speak. I realize that this course of instruction will be read and studied by as many different sorts of people as there are different trades and professions, for I have students in every walk of life. Grand opera singers, government officials, editors, nationally known columnists, scientists, Catholic priests, preachers, butchers. In fact, I think I may safely say that every walk of life is represented in my student files. But it makes no difference, for as previously stated, the God law is no respecter of persons. It works the same way for all. So do these simple little exercises. Most people in this day and age go along at breakneck speed and at the highest nervous tension. They do not know what relaxation means. They gulp down their meals, rush here, rush there, and even when they go to bed, they toss and roll most of the night. These exercises of mine will do at least one thing, but it's an important thing though. They will teach you how to positively rest every muscle in your body. And if they never do more than that, they are worth alone many times the cost of this course. For when absolute physical relaxation is indulged in every night, I will tell you that it isn't very long until one knows that they are being benefited through such relaxation. But these exercises will do far more than teach you how to relax. They are designed by me to do far more than that, for they deal directly with the thought realm, which, of course, is the unseen realm. After a while, you will probably change your ideas about thoughts. Today, you may probably think, oh, well, a thought is just something or other that keeps going through my head. Everybody thinks and they can't help it. That may be what you think now, but I have an idea that before you and I get through with each other, you will have a far different opinion of your thoughts. What I am after at this stage of your journey is to get you every night into a state of absolute relaxation. Then, two, I am doing something else. I'm directing your thoughts into the unseen thought realm. You will recall that we have seen that every manifested thing first had its origin in the thought realm. Well, that is exactly where I am leading you, into the thought realm. Or to be more precise and exact, into the realm of manifestation. Or to be still more correct, into the realm of the God law. Here, you are beginning to see a little more clearly, I think, just what I am trying to do. But don't be impatient. Take your time. You probably have been dissatisfied and unhappy a long time now, and you can afford to spend the next few months studying with me. Here we are then, in bed, and we are utterly relaxed. Every muscle is at ease. We are breathing slowly and filling the lungs to the full with fresh breath. We are slowly exhaling. We are very quiet. All clocks and other ticking things are out of the room. We are prepared to drop off into a natural, quiet sleep. We close our eyes. We don't move a muscle. And the first thing we know, we do not even feel the physical body at all. First, the toes go to sleep. Then our hands get numb and they are asleep. Then sleep slowly and almost unconsciously creeps up our legs and into our arms. We are still awake, remember. We do not move a muscle, but just lie there like a log of wood. And now comes the important part of the exercises. We are still conscious, and our eyes are directed into the field of vision as we see it. Keep the eyes closed. There's always one certain part of the field of vision which is lighter than any other part. It moves with the eyes. This is true even though our eyes are shut tight, and even though the room be pitch dark. There's always that one area in which it seems lighter than any other area in this field of closed eye vision. You will probably find this bright area very easily, but by way of warning, let me say that you will not find it until you are relaxed as fully as you possibly can. To those who have not found it yet, let me say that you must keep on until you find it. It isn't hard to find it, for this white or bright area is the part of you which is very close to the realm of the God law. The idea now is to take the little affirmation I shall give from time to time, and without any attempt on your part to carry them into your sleep, let the affirmation you are working on be carried by your thought right into that bright area, and to the exclusion of every other thought. For instance, last lesson I gave you the affirmation, I am finding the power of the living God. Now, for the next 2 weeks, use this affirmation carefully and faithfully. My thoughts are part of the living God. I don't want you to try and force anything at all this time. You should be in a condition of semi-sleep, utterly relaxed, lying there in bed as motionless as a log, and with part of you half asleep as it were, and then direct this above affirmation into the very depths of your being. and you will be doing this by directing it right into that brighter area in your field of vision. Shortly, you will drop off to sleep without knowing it, and a definite step along the road of your understanding of the mighty unseen power of God will have been accomplished. You probably will not know it, but it won't be very long until you begin to realize that something is happening in you. For these thoughts are powerful things, and they come direct from the mighty life spirit. And more important than all, they go back to the same creative life principle. Remember this well. Every thought you think under these circumstances goes direct to the originator of all life and the originator of what we now call thought. We may see a little later that thought is a far more potent and dynamic thing than we ever suspected. I don't want to anticipate, however. All I want you to do is to follow me closely through every move I suggest and advise. I shall probably open your eyes before you have finished this course of instruction. Don't forget, on awakening, fill your lungs with pure air. Open your windows and get down to the very bottom of those lungs. Chances are, you only use a fraction of them when you should be using them to their full capacity. Many people write me asking if calisthenics are a good thing. Yes, they are a fine, good thing for the physical body, and there is, of course, a very vital connection between the physical and the spiritual. And as long as too much stress is not laid on calisthenics, and as long as they are not overdone, they are very good, for the time being at any rate. Through the day, whenever opportunity occurs, let this same thought I have given you to be in your mind to the exclusion of every other thought. You will notice that in these exercises, I very seldom use the word mind. And where I do use it is only because the use of it is handy. I have a very definite reason for not doing so. And as you progress, you will have a very revolutionary definition of mind given to you. You do as I ask, though, and hold this one thought every moment in which you comfortably can do so. And remember, above all, the most important part of this work is the relaxation exercises at night and the impressing of the affirmation into the very center of your being, and perhaps farther than that. Our next lesson will go into the subject of who and what God actually is. This next lesson has brought more favorable comment than anything I have ever written. This present lesson number 3 has brought many, many favorable letters to me, but the next lesson is a very vital one, as you will know when it reaches you. You have never had such an explanation of God given to you as the next lesson will give you, and the thought will probably revolutionize all your previous ideas of this great power. It will also throw a flood of light on the lessons you have received to date. In fact, it will throw a flood of light into your whole life itself. It has been said many times that I was inspired when I wrote this lesson, perhaps so, but every soul living in touch with the God law is inspired to just the extent he or she can assimilate that marvelous law, for truly marvelous it is. We will not anticipate, however, but will do the work in our hands well, so that we shall be ready for lesson 4 when it comes in 2 weeks. Points to remember in lesson number 3. First, the very same power responsible for creation, and especially responsible for you, is still here with you, waiting to be used by you for the achievement of every good and right thing you can desire. This power did not put you here and go away, leaving you to your own resources, but stayed right here with you. Second, you are now, through the course and exercises, laying the foundation of the things you desire to manifest in your life in the future. Lay that foundation exactly as I tell you to. What you are today is the result of what you and others thought years ago. What you will be in the future depends largely on what you think today. Think the thought given in the lesson and think it to the exclusion of all other thoughts. Third, adopt the mental attitude that the things you desire are already in existence somewhere, and the actual manifestation of them has begun. This is absolutely a fact. As the architect first plans in his thought realm the building he is to build, so you are now planning the future you are to enjoy or not to enjoy. There is in this world or in this creation somewhere more than sufficient of everything to satisfy your needs, and do it without robbing someone else. So keep an expectant attitude, expect the best, and be ready for it when it comes. Don't do these exercises nor go ahead with this course unless you prepare yourself to expect and really do expect better things to come to pass in your life. It would be a pity if the God law had been complied with, and you, through your own attitude of non-expectancy, were to miss the goal, would it not? Well, that can happen, so be expectant. And the more expectant you are, the surer will the manifestation be. Fourth, be absolutely on the level with me, with yourself and with your fellow men and women. Downright crookedness will invariably defeat the law, and there is no need for it in the first place. So as a matter of business alone, if for no other reason, be on the level with everyone for your own good. Every wrong deed brings its own reward and may hinder the workings of the God law. When you know this mighty law better, automatically you will never bother your head with anything that does not comply with the God law. I'm not preaching now, for I quit preaching a long time ago. I'm merely telling you, you will get along faster playing the same game on the square with everybody. That is the end of lesson 3 of Psychiana. And once again, the main thought to carry into your sleep is, my thoughts are part of the living God. Say that repeatedly. As I have done these exercises in the first few weeks, I am finding the power of the God. I believe in the power of the living God. As I have done that, it has changed. As you continually do it at night as you sleep, and I may create some sleep meditations around this, but you can do it on your own. It's just a thought that you're creating on a repetitive basis. And I really love the way he structured these simple affirmations as a way to enter into our understanding of God. I enjoy and really thought it was very daring of him, considering the time that this was written, for him to question religion. This is 1930s. So I'm sure that there was a lot of resistance to his ideas. Now, I believe the Bible is symbolic. That's how I read the Bible and the creation story. It's all symbolic. Everything from the days, every word of it is symbolic as an example of me, as I understand it through Neville Goddard. And so I agree with what he is saying, and it has been distorted and twisted, but we're really getting down to an idea of the power of our minds in conjunction with the power of God. And I think this course is a really good course. If you've struggled in the past to understand these, it's simple, it's easy. Take it step by step or one lesson at a time. Each of these lessons are powerful and can carry and amplify your ability to create your reality and to have health, success, and happiness, as he indicates. So keep an eye out for lesson 4 in 2 weeks, and I'll continue to produce these every 2 weeks, and just wanted to tell you that I love you and hope you're having a fantastic day, and welcome to the Reality Revolution.